Oh man, you feeling the Christmas spirit?
Oh, ho, ho.
Yeah, next week we're gonna have to have like terrible Christmas sweater week, so be sure to dust off the old sweater wardrobe there, Foxy.
Yeah, I mean, I've got like two, so maybe I'll put on my coat.
Two Christmas ones? You got a Christmas coat?
I have a winter coat.
If I wore a Santa hat, would you be my elven helper?
Do I get an elf hat?
Yes.
Okay.
All right. We'll get props and set right on that.
Oh, wait, that's me.
Yep.
Okay.
December is in full swing. Thanksgiving is behind us. And we have some pretty awesome comics this week. All right, let's dive into this top five, because we have an awesome top five as well as an honorable mention. We haven't done an honorable mention in a while.
We haven't.
It was really, really just too difficult to determine what should be five and what should not be. So we gave an honorable mention. And this week, we're talking about The Humans, issue number two. This story is growing on me. And not only because I felt bad that maybe they thought that we were hating on it a few weeks ago. This book, again, exactly like issue number one, does everything that it is trying to do very, very well.
Totally.
That's the story of a biker who was in a biker gang, goes to Vietnam, comes back, the world's kind of changed, it's kind of moved past him, and now he's trying to figure out where he fits in.
And he's not comfortable with being called a hero for what he did over there, which...
Yeah.
It makes this character more relatable immediately than any of the other characters, so it was a good addition to the book.
So definitely an honorable mention, and the last two pages, really cool art.
Probably, yeah.
Definitely my favorite art of this series so
we
far.
Couldn't show them on the YouTubes, because they have...
Inappropriate
act, but very cool colors, very cool art.
And I also really like, speaking of the covers, I like it's a trend that Image is going with now, just not caring what's on the cover. I can see where it's going to get some shops in some trouble, but hey, I'll stand by them. Thank you for not sending it as the Image display, though. Which I'm still loving. By the way, thank you, Image. Coming in at number five on our top five list, it is a book that I probably swore a few times would never make it onto the top five list.
I swore I would never read it.
Well, and here we are, living and learning, because what does Avatar go and do? They get Alan Moore to go and write The Crossed Plus 100. Now, The Crossed Plus 100 is it's set in the Crossed universe, created by Garth Ennis, but it is set 100 years after the first... So they're way out in the future, and the Crossed have sort of... They're no longer the threat that they were. Like, humanity has survived that storm.
Yeah, it seems like, at least in this region, they assume that they're mostly gone. Like, there aren't really any.
Yeah, you see a few, but they're, like, super not threatening, like they were in some of the other Crossed series. And, but the main reason why this book comes onto the top five list is because Alan Moore wrote it, and Alan Moore did something really, really cool with this one. The language we use now is not the same as the language we used 100 years ago, nor would it be the same as the language that they speak 100 years from now.
Yeah, I thought it was a really believable evolution of language. You know, there's a lot of words in there that you just have to kind of sit with it. Once you get to the end of the book, you can kind of go back and reread some of the earlier pages and understand what was being said.
Yeah, I mean, once again, Alan Moore showcasing why he's one of the best writers.
He's a genius.
He is. He's very good. In Garth Ennis' defense, though, the first volume of The Crossed, very different from all the subsequent ones. Very good. Really, really like that one. The other ones, like, yeah, it gets a little over the top.
Well, the first volume was when it was more about the concept, and then the subsequent volumes seem like it's more about torture porn.
Yeah, like Saw.
Yeah, which I hate.
If you love Saw, read all the Crossed. If you don't like Saw, you should still read Crossed Plus 100, because it is extremely well written, extremely well thought out, and, like, I mean, it was just cool. Like, everything about it was cool, which is why it's five. Coming in at number four, continuing with the theme of cool, awesome things, it's Hellboy and the B.P.R.D. 1952. This is a number one.
Yeah, it's Hellboy's first field mission, and... You know, it's mostly a new cast of characters that he's along the ride with, so this first issue is more of a introduction, like getting to know all the faces that are going to be prominent for this five-issue run.
Mm-hmm. Not my favorite Hellboy or BPRD story, but both of those universes are so rich that it's hard to write a bad BPRD book.
You know, they just got to get it You want to go in subtle when you've got a big story to tell and you've got a bunch of characters to introduce, I think.
Yep. I look forward to the subsequent issues. Man, speaking of books that came out of the bullpen swinging, Wolf Moon, number one.
I'm feeling it.
It's not a full moon yet.
Okay.
Maybe it is, though, soon.
It's inspiring me. That's all I'm saying.
That. Yeah, I know. Well, you should not be inspired to
I've been working out.
Any of the animals in this book, Foxy.
I was inspired by Baltimore's werewolf, and then this Wolf Moon werewolf is like, seems to be much more powerful. You felt the raw power on that page.
I mean, werewolf's terrifying to begin with. Like, it resonates in your soul.
Yeah, these people are not just being killed. They're being, like, torn asunder and thrown. It's the strength of the wolf is amazing. I don't know. And you really feel it coming through with the panels.
Yeah. This book, I was really glad to see a really strong Vertigo number one. They've been trying really hard to bring that whole, like, publishing company back.
This is a strong one to put on the roster.
Yeah. Is really strong. I wish Colin Bunn would do more creator-owned things.
His creator-owned is always his best stuff, yeah.
Yeah.
Definitely.
Yeah.
And, hey, thanks, Colin. You gave us that shout-out on Playboy.com.
Oh, yeah. You the man.
One of the top ten shops in America. We'll take it.
And you get to be one of the top five comics that came out this week. Coming in at number two is Tooth and Claw issue number two. This one shipped with two covers, one by the regular artist and one by Alex Ross. Both really cool.
The Ben Dewey wraparound cover is actually really spectacular.
It is. They're both excellent covers. I almost like the Ben Dewey one more, which is weird because I'm a huge Alex Ross fan.
But, totally.
And anytime you can even like compare a cover to an Alex Ross cover, you know you have a good artist.
I had a hard time picking. I just bought both.
Yeah. Despite not progressing the story very far geographically, wow, does it progress the story on a whole different kind of level. We finally get to see what the
champion.
We get to see the champion. Things are really bad for the beasts right now.
The Sky Beast. Well, I guess all the beasts. Yeah. It's pretty bad. It's a bad scene for all the beasts.
Yeah, it's nothing. Nothing is good. If you're a land beast, you are not happy by the end of the issue. If you're a sky beast, you are really not happy at the beginning of the issue.
Or you're probably not alive anymore.
And if you're either, you're probably not alive by the end of the issue. But the champion was cool.
The champion seems to be the least detailed in rendering, which I thought was a little strange to have a full page splash on a character that is less detailed than the other characters.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
That's all I want to say about it without being spoilery.
Yeah, that's pretty much all you can say without being spoilery.
Doesn't really detract from the book a lot. You know, it's still a powerful reveal and really cool story.
Mm-hmm.
Just a strange moment where you're like, huh, I wonder why.
Yeah. Tooth and Claw is fantastic, top to bottom. That's all I can say about it.
Absolutely.
And the only reason it's not number one is because Low number five came out this week.
Oh, yeah.
And Low number five was amazing. Probably my favorite, definitely my favorite Remendir book that's I'm reading right now.
Remendir. That's how I like to say it. Yeah. Remendir.
But love the art for this book. The art is superb. The story is great. And I love how each, like, two issues, one issue, were, like, jumping from, like, along the timeline of this story. And looks like maybe we're finally going to get settled down into a little bit of a conclusion for this arc.
Yeah, next issue is the last for this arc. This one hangs on a precarious edge.
Mm-hmm.
I think I know what's coming up in the next issue, but I don't want to speculate too hard for the people who need to catch up.
Yeah, my one knock on the series before this issue was that the character development, they were introducing tons of characters, but you never really got a sense of who they are or what they were doing, their hopes and their dreams and all of those things. This issue and four took that worry right off my plate. They're like, oh no, here's all of these characters and you love every single one of them. Even the villains. I love, what is it, Groll?
The Groll? One in the robot-y suit thing.
Robot-y dude with a skull face that can talk to the sea animals.
Yeah,
I really
want
to know how that power works.
Mm-hmm.
The gladiator matches were insane.
Mm-hmm.
Everything about Low, it is a wonderful science fiction book that doesn't actually leave Earth, which is cool.
Rick Remender said, Remender says that.
Thanks, get it right. He might watch,
but he says that he was with this one. He really wanted to take his time, and normally his crutch in writing is action, 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 action. Just like throw it out there as fast as you can, as hard as you can, and as regularly as you can. And with Low, he said he wanted to do the complete opposite. He wants to do a slow-paced introduction, and this is all really, the first six issues is just a preamble for the bigger story he has in mind.
Yeah, and you can definitely see that, because there is so much that's only very vaguely alluded to throughout so much of these first five issues. And, didn't they also talk about possibly doing a Black Science?
Yeah, he mentions there have already been thoughts among the creative teams about doing a low Black Science crossover, which, if it happens, will happen in Black Science, he says.
Yeah.
Which is appropriate.
It is appropriate. And that needs to happen. Get on.
Yeah, now that they mention it, it's like, okay.
I can't live without...
Start the clock. When's this happening?
But that'll do it for our top five. Fox, you have anything else to say about the top five?
No, that'd be good.
That'll do it for our top five. We will be right back from this cutaway with a look at the previews catalog that came out last week. We finally got a chance to read it, and now we're going to tell you what you should be excited for in February.
Or at least what I'm excited for.
Yeah. And me too.
Yeah.
Which really means you should be excited for it too. First off, it's still up for order. It is in the current catalog. I guess they haven't sold them all yet. But it is the original Little Nemo.
It's a collection of news stories, though. But it's in the original size format to, like, recreate, like, the experience of reading on this Sunday newspaper.
The names of the contributors to this is awesome.
It's a who's who of the most awesome people you could think of. Paul Pope.
Bill Sienkiewicz, Mike Allred, J.H. Williams III, Cliff Chiang, Craig Thompson, both Gabriel Ba and Fabio Moon.
J.G. Jones.
Charles Vess. Farrell DeRimple.
John Cassaday? Did you mention him already?
I didn't mention John Cassaday, and that is like an odd, you know, name in the list.
For a book that's all about imagination, those are some imaginative people.
Definitely.
Oh, we didn't talk about just the tips.
Oh, just the tips.
Brief segue before we really get into this list of things we're excited about. So there's a Just the Tips book put out as the companion to Sex Criminals, and it is probably the funniest book ever written.
Hours of adult entertainment for only $12.99. I almost didn't get any of this week's books read last night because we were my neighbors and I were laughing about it so hard.
If you know anybody between the ages of 18 and...
Dead.
Get them this book as a Christmas gift. It's $12.99. It's a great price.
This is the ultimate stocking stuffer.
Yeah.
That's for sure.
No, this is the Cards Against Humanity of 2015... 2014 holidays.
Definitely.
Anyway, that's our rant about Just the Tips. We can't go into it too much because it's wildly inappropriate.
And we'll show an interior, but it won't be any of the drawings because all of the drawings have boobies in
somebody's
them.
Somebody's eyeballs and above. all very cartoony drawings. It's great. And insanely witty.
I love that they have time to do this in between almost never putting out issues of their comic. That's awesome.
Yeah, it is good.
They found the time to make a different book that's ancillary related. Cool.
All right, so let's see. Things that we are excited for from the current previews catalog. From Marvel, we have Spider-Gwen number one. That'll be in stores in February. The wildly popular,
Edge of Spider-Verse book, mm-hmm. which originally wasn't called Spider-Gwen, but they're just like, the internet calls it Spider-Gwen. We must obey.
We can't change it. Nobody's going to buy it unless we call it Spider-Gwen. Silk, number one, also comes out.
Yeah, also growing out of the Spider-Verse. It's that new the new character in the 616 that also has the spider powers. And the interior artist, I've never heard of, but it actually looks really good. Dave Johnson on cover is always a nice thing.
Yes. On a sad note, Mark Waid is going to be entering his final run on Daredevil.
Yeah.
Very sad. Don't miss out on that if you've missed out on all the other Mark Waid runs. Definitely be around for the last one. It's bound to make me cry.
Yeah.
I don't cry. The original graphic novel by Rick Remender, Rage of Ultron, with Jerome Opeña and Darren White. That's going to be coming out, and that should get you totally pumped for the new Avengers movie. And the Darth Vader number one.
Yeah.
By Carillion and De La Roca. What's his first name?
Salvador.
Salvador. Thank you. Thank you, Foxy.
Yeah.
Salvador de la Roca, which is a fun name to say. And it's going to be an awesome book to read because it's about Darth Vader.
Mm-hmm.
And on a side note, the Thor annual will feature the first comic book written by CM Punk.
Totally.
Which is kind of cool.
And Rob Gilroy from Chew is also contributing to that issue.
Thank you.
It's going to be indie fab.
Yeah, it's gonna be a good annual. I'm not usually big on annuals, but that one does sound interesting. All right, other things we're excited about from Dark Horse, Raphael Albuquerque, fan favorite from American Vampire, has a new series coming out that he is illustrating and writing. It's called 8. It looks fantastic. I'm excited to see how his writing style holds up on it. Next up, Grant Morrison has a new Image number 1 coming out. It's called Nameless.
Looks awesome.
Looks amazing. Do not ask me what it is about, because I will not be able to tell you until it is over.
It's Grant Morrison doing some crazy business with aliens and like sigils on their suits.
Aliens and occults and murders.
And awesome Chris Burnham art.
Yeah.
So.
It's going to be fantastic. The Surface is a book that I'm intrigued about by Alice Kott and
Langdon Foss
doing the art.
It's an Alice Kott book, so it's another one where, like, you know, good luck knowing what it's about until we're knee deep in it.
Mm hmm. Mm hmm. But his Winter Soldier run has been pretty sweet, so, you know. Yeah. And I really liked, a few years ago, he did Wild Child, for Vertigo. That was awesome. From the Mind of Scott McCloud, we have The Sculptor.
A new original, fiction from the author of Understanding Comics, Making Comics, Reinventing Comics. This guy is like...
Zot, also.
Yeah, and Zot. He used to do narrative structures, then he took a long break to be like... the scholar of comics, mm-hmm. to really like break it down into a school,
which good for him, because it needed that. The industry needed that when he
totally
died.
It's still like the go-to if people are like new to comics, or especially if they're interested in creating them. Mm-hmm. It's brilliant.
Next, from the indie section of the book, we have Displacement by Lucy Nisley, is how we're gonna say we pronounce
it, because it has a KN, so that's like knife. I say
Nisley. And if we're wrong, please call us and come into the store for a signing.
Yeah, and it's a travel log of her going on a cruise with her frail grandparents and kind of coming to terms with her own mortality and stuff. It sounds really interesting, and she was the author of Relish, mm-hmm. Which came out last year, and it was really cool.
So yeah, February is going to be a pretty rocking month, unless you're owned by Warner Brothers.
I'm sure they'll do fine. Snap. I'm sure Batman will be number one or whatever, as it always is.
As always. We have a few words of the show that we're going to get to briefly. First off, there was a book that came out last week from Boom Studios that we forgot to talk about, and I have a deep, deep apology for the creators of this book. It's called Capture Creature.
Yeah!
It was awesome.
It was so hilarious.
Laugh out loud funny. I was in stitches.
It's got a Steven Universe vibe, the character design as well as the comedy stylings, but... it's promising to be, you know, like the solicit said it was Pokemon, basically.
Yeah.
So it's Pokemon meets Steven Universe, apparently.
Mm-hmm.
And the art is by Becky Drysdat. She's awesome at creatures. So the first one, you just get a taste of the creatures, but the second issue should be creature heavy, I'm assuming.
Yeah, they're going to Creature Island.
They're going to Creature Island. But the first creature that you meet is adorable.
Is he your new spirit animal?
He's very inspirational to me. He's got a bad attitude, which I can get behind.
Yeah, I was going to say, that's really familiar.
Yeah.
Just kidding.
If only I could control flames.
We'd be in
trouble. I do covet that power, you sir.
That and a werewolf.
Oh, yeah.
Are the two things that you covet.
If I was a flaming werewolf, you'd be in trouble.
Instead, you're just a flaming fox.
I don't know what you're implying.
I don't know either.
Forest language doesn't match up with your human colloquialisms.
Oh, I'm just kidding, Foxy. You're my favorite. Shout out to my boy Wolverine from around the shop. He is very excited because this weekend in Albuquerque, we have The Good, the Bad, and the Ladders live pro wrestling December 6th from 7 to 10 p.m. What is awesome about this, I'm going to be fighting on the ladder match for the world belt. I believe it hasn't been worn in 4 years. Well, the professionals. But they're not like WWE.
Oh, okay.
Like, so you're going to get actually more wrestling than you would at the WWE.
Also, I know one of the other wrestlers that's going to be in it is Rey Basura, and he's a big comic fan. So this isn't completely irrelevant.
Bam. It's mostly still irrelevant, but kind of cool. And that is going to be at the McKernan Event Center. I don't know where that is. But tickets start at $12.
And then people's elbow.
Oh! And yeah. With that, we're done for this show. See you next week.